Student Army High School. My name is Swarupa Ramizadi from Class 17. My project topic is Terrace Sunbath. India is close enough to the equator to receive sufficient ultraviolet B radiation, wavelength 290 to 315 nanometers, year round, and therefore should not experience poor vitamin D status. However, evidence indicates otherwise. Suboptimal status of vitamin D has been reported among diverse groups of adults, children, pregnant women, elderly people, etc., belonging to urban and rural and affluent and non-affluent sector. How is vitamin D produced in the body? Approximately 90% of the vitamin D requirement are met by ultraviolet radiation, which penetrates the skin and converts 7-dehydrocholesterol to 25-hydroxyl vitamin D, which is further converted to 1,25 dihydroxyl vitamin D. Most of the vitamin D is obtained from the ultraviolet B radiations, which is present in the sunlight, whereas contribution from the dietary sources is limited. In India, the contribution from the dietary sources is poor because many foods are not fortified with vitamin D. Various religious myths or beliefs, that is vegetarianism, which prohibits intake of fish, such as salmon, tuna, and sardines, which are oily fish and rich in vitamin D, are not taken in Indian culture. Therefore, they take milk, egg, and cheese, which leads to vitamin D deficiency. The symptoms of vitamin D deficiency are body ache, back ache, muscle weakness, joint pains, osteomalacia in adults, and rickets in children. What is the function of vitamin D in our body? Vitamin D helps in keeping our bones strong by regulation of calcium and phosphate metabolism. Calcium plays an important role in bone mineralization, muscle contraction, working of the nervous system, and the other cellular activities.
My name is Arishai from 7th year, roll number 18. Today, I will speak about my model pulse oximeter, a common apparatus which is being used during this pandemic of coronavirus. A pulse oximeter is a non-invasive and a painless test that measures the oxygen saturation level inside the body. It is a small, clip-like device that attaches to the parts of the body like the finger, earlobe, or the toe. It is commonly put on our finger and is oftenly used in level inside your blood. So how does this small clip-like device work? First, switch on this pulse oximeter. You can see the word pulse oximeter on the screen of this device. Now, what you have to do is just place your finger inside the pulse oximeter. But before this, I want to say about that. Inside the pulse oximeter, you can see a small red light. This small red light will measure the oxygen saturation level inside. So, my oxygen saturation level is 98 and my heart rate is 114. So, how does this take place? First, what happens? The small beams of light pass through the blood present in your finger, thus measuring the oxygen saturation level. Second, it does this by measuring the changes of light absorption in the oxygenated and the deoxygenated blood. It's a painless process. Thus, the pulse oximeter will be able to tell you about the oxygen saturation level inside your blood along with the heart rate. So it's my humble request that the normal saturation inside the blood is between 95 and 100. So it's a humble request that you all should keep at least one pulse oximeter at your office, especially to the people who have old people, sick people, or people suffering from fever or cough showing the symptoms of COVID-19. So it's a handful request to keep this useful machine at your houses. Thank you.
name is Aranyak Mahapatra from class 7th going to demonstrate a project named an indicator. It will be very helpful to the domestic usage to warn the people about a sudden rain. It will also warn the people inside the building to get the clothes from outside. We all know that water is a good conductor of electricity. With keeping the properties of water in mind, I have made an instrument with a circuit inside it which will work whenever the rainwater will fill the small gap at the two ends of wire, and the buzzer will indicate by making a sound. Now I will demonstrate in detail the components part of the rain indicator. The whole structure is made up of cardboard. The sensors are made up of two coins. Inside it, there are some wires, 2 9 volt batteries, a 3 volt buzzer, a switch, and a LED to indicate that the rain indicator is running.
Now I will describe the circuit diagram of the rain indicator. The buzzer is powered by cell 1. The spacing between the two coins blocks the negative current to the buzzer. So to able to reach a negative current to the buzzer, the raindrops has to fall between the gaps and have to fill the gaps to able to reach the negative current to the buzzer. The positive current of the buzzer is blocked by the switch. So to able to reach the positive current to the buzzer, we have to on the switch. The LED is powered by cell 1 and uses the same switch to on and off. So when the switch is on, the LED glows, which indicates that the positive current is reaching the buzzer. When the rainwater drops between the gap of the coins, the negative current reaches the buzzer and the buzzer beeps, indicating that there is a sudden rain.
Now we will test the rain indicator. For this, I have some water. But first, we will on the rain indicator light. The LED indicates that the rain indicator is running. There is a very small gap between the two coins. Now we will put some drops of water inside it. The buzzer indicates that the whole system is working. Thank you.
Good morning, teachers, jury, and my dear friends. Today I am going to perform a water filtration activity as my Nirman project. This water filtration activity helps us to perform different kinds of water filtration activity and helps us to know more about water filtration. This activity involves 3 particle sizes of granites and activated carbon and filter paper. This activity first needs a clear, clean, empty container and 4 cups fixed with it, and 3 of them needs 3 types of granites and activated carbon. Then when I pour the water through the funnel, it goes through each and every particles, even the activated carbon, which helps in vanishing the mud and the color. Through that experiment, we have clean, clear water. In this way, we get filtered water. Thank you.
Hello everyone, thank you for having me. My name is Avni Jingade, 7th A, roll number 3. Today we are going to speak about our Nirman project, which is microcontroller. Now my friend Rama will take over.
So the participants are Avni, Shanti, and me as myself, Rama. So now I will tell you what is the microcontroller. This is the picture of the microcontroller. Microcontroller is a small computer on a single metal oxide semiconductor integrated chip. A microcontroller contains one or more CPUs along with memory and programmable input/output. Microcontroller is a device which controls very big embedded system. For example, in a microwave, we want to bake a cake at 200 degrees. Then we put the cake in it and starts to rise the temperature to 200 degrees. Then the microcontroller will tell the heating unit of the microwave to stop at 200 degrees, or it can also rise up to 250. So the microcontroller will control the microwave. Now my friend Amri will tell you some uses of microcontroller.
Microcontroller uses are automatically control devices like such as office machine, power tools, remote control, toys and other system. Microcontroller are 4-bit words which is lowest frequency at 4KHZ, and they are having lowest battery. They are having ability of frequency which can press a button and input, and this will be helping for the long lasting of battery. Now my friend Shayanti will take over it, and she is going to explain about the advantage and disadvantage of microcontroller.
We are connecting electroluminescent wires, which are colorful wires with extension cord and has microcontrollers in it. So when we switch it on, the color is going to be green, which means we have not used any of our electricity. Slowly the color changes to blue, which means we have used enough electricity. And then slowly it will turn into orange and so on. By the time it reaches the color red, it means we have wasted a lot of electricity and it is time to shut down. This can help us in saving electricity and spreading awareness among the people. Thank you.
Good morning everyone. My name is Diya Madan from class 7A.
And my name is Sanmaya Upadhyay from class 7A.
So today our topic is solar power drip irrigation. So Sanmaya, what is the meaning of solar power drip irrigation?
Drip irrigation is the most efficient water and nutrients delivery system for growing crops. It is delivered to plants through plant's root zone.
So how does it work?
Water and nutrients are delivered across the field in pipes called dripper lines, featuring smaller units known as drippers. Each dripper emits drops containing water and fertilizers, resulting in the uniform application of water and nutrients direct to each plant's root zone across an entire field. So I would like to ask you a question, that why do farmers prefer drip irrigation?
It is very simple. Farmer prefer drip irrigation not only for ROI, but it is also efficient and simple to use by the farmers on the farm. Higher consistent water yields, huge water savings. That means no water is wasted in this process. Less dependency on weather, efficient use of water, light and energies. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello everyone, today I am going to show you a science experiment on vacuum tower. For this experiment we need candle, matchsticks and some colored water. First we need to light up the candle. Then put some water. Now put the glass on this. Atmospheric tower bottoms are injected into the vacuum tower under a pressure at the bottom of 1/20th of atmospheric pressure. Under this low pressure, the atmospheric pressure resides will vaporize at temperature below those where it starts to crack. Thank you.
Project mechanical tube. Let me tell you about our advanced mechanical tube and its advantages. Tube or swim tube is also known as swim ring. It helps us to float on water. It is used to have fun in water, or it helps us during flood. After seeing the regular tube, we all decided to rebuild it with some more innovative ideas. Now, my friend Soham will continue.
Now, what you can see in our model of mechanical tube. Mechanical tube is a spherical shape and lightweighted. We have made this tube into spherical shape because it will help the people to whisk and floods. Due to its lightweight, it can move faster and easily. We have attached a steering wheel within it, so that it will help the person to move in whichever direction they want when the waves are slow. Now my friend Ansh will continue.
Hello, my name is Ansh Shetty. Today I am going to explain you the special features of our project, the mechanical tube. The first special feature of our mechanical tube is that it has a GPS system attached to it, which helps the rescue team to locate and rescue the people inside it. Another feature is that it has oxygen tanks, it has life jackets, it has lighting facility, and it has food arrangement. It also has chairs and beds so that the people could survive in the mechanical tube for 2 to 3 weeks. Another feature is that it has ladders on both the sides so that the people could climb the ladder and then go inside. When going inside, there is a glass opening, as you can see over here, which is connected to a button which will be located over here. When this button has been clicked, this glass opens and then the people could climb inside. Now my friend Dev Goyal will continue. Thank you.
Now I'm going to tell you some advantages of our mechanical tube. Our mechanical tube has oxygen cylinders in it. Our mechanical tube has a huge space where people can sit, stand and sleep. Our mechanical tube has a huge storage where you can store 2-3 weeks of food. Our mechanical tube has a glass wall through which passengers can see the outside conditions. Our mechanical tube weight is 500 kilos, which makes it easy to carry from one place to another place. Thank you for being a part of our project.
This project, the mechanical tube, is made possible by the help of our respected teacher and our friends Dev Goyal, Janvi Agarwal, Soham Parmar and myself Ansh Shetty. I hope you would like our project and you may use it for future purposes. We would be very pleased if you use our project for future purposes. Thank you.
Good afternoon, respected ma'am and venerable present here. Today, I, Nathania Singh, would explain you about my project. My project is based on solar consumption. It involves arts and science involved in it. We can see that there is a garden which has a beautiful greenery around it. We can also see that there are some solar panels and light around the garden. The function of the solar panel is to absorb the sunlight of the sun during the daytime, and at night it would use the energy stored and would light up all the lightings around the garden. The use of all the lightings around the garden would be helpful as it is safe for our environment and would the light would light up by its own. By using this technology in our future would help us to save our environment and live a better future ahead. Thank you.
Hello everyone, this is Mehak Walani
and this is Inshika Yadav. So today our topic is water purification with charcoal.
So the materials used to purify the dirty water are charcoal and sand.
So here we will convert dirty water to clean water by the technique used. So we will pour some muddy water in sand and charcoal. And now the clean water will be purified from the bottle.
coming in some small drops. It'll take some more time. As you can see, the clean water has come up. Other than being cheap and easy way to make the homemade water purifiers to assure the high quality of pure and hygienic water.
It removes unwanted impurities while holding on to a few essential minerals.
Overall, homemade water purifiers assure us to stay away from the harmful bacteria and toxins. Thank you.
Good morning, respected teachers. I am Sola Panchal from 7th A. Today's my topic is mini escalator. We all know what is an escalator. This is just a mini concept presentation for better understanding of modern technology. Now I have completed the stairs on the sellotape. So this is my final product. The motor didn't work properly. Since the lockdown, I couldn't click the higher voltage motor. So I tried my best during the project.
One can see properly.
What to do now?
Idea! Let's make a smartphone projector.
Okay.
Good morning to all my respected teacher and my dear friend. My name is Harshal and we are going to explain our project smartphone projector. How's the video on the wall is much bigger than the video on the smartphone. That's the whole point of the projector, right? Well, then this explanation lies on the lenses of the magnifying glass, the convex lenses. The convex lenses are the lenses that are thicker on the middle than on the edges. The light coming from your smartphone goes through the straight line, and then when it reaches the focal point, it bends and converges. From the focal point, the light disperses into two opposite directions, stopping by the surface. That's why the video gets bigger the further the projector is away from the wall. However, the video gets also gets less sharp. Now, my friend Puranjay Rathore will.
This is also the reason we see a video upside down. The light coming from a focal point is projected in the opposite direction. This is why we need to turn on a smartphone upside down to get a correct image. Do you know that the human eye works similarly? The image we receive is upside down. The lens in our eyes is focusing light from the environment on the retina. This makes a small process occurs. The brain then makes a necessary correction which perceives the world around it and make it regular shape and direction. The next para is continuing with my friend dear Suhit.
Your phone gets upside down when you put into the box, and the magnifying glasses are lot smaller than the image on the screen. It seems a little weird, right? You probably know that the human's eye see the images upside down. So it could be, well, it is a little incorrection made by your brain. The homemade projector can help us visualizing this concept. The human eyes have lens in it, and the magnifying glasses are attached to this. The lens flips the image right side up as it passes through it, going from upside down phone to screen. Your eyes flips the image to the correct orientation. So that's why set your phone as properly. You have to outthink your thinker. Now my friend will say ahead part. Now my friend Diye will say the ahead part.
But how about the image on the screen? It's way bigger than the lens in the magnifying glass. This works because of the shape of the lens and the fact that light travels in straight line. A convex lens has shape where the middle is thicker than the edges, rather than a convex lens which is thicker in the middle than at the edges. The shape of the convex lens allows it to catch, bend and focus for more light. Coming from the phone inside the box, once you have a dark enough space, by darkening the theater, the magnifying glass will gather, focus and project the light coming from the phone to screen and you see images. Thank you and have a great day.
Hello friends, my name is Divyajit Bahedi from class 7th A and then Dalmia High School. In this pandemic situation, I know we all have learned something new or done something creative. I have also learned something new, which is Vedic Mathematics. It's an ancient way to calculate large amount of number in an easy and quick manner. On the occasion of Nirmana exhibition, I will share with you couple of tricks which will definitely help us in our semester and exam. So let's move on to trick number one. Trick number one is basically about multiplying two digits with two numbers which end with the digit 5. For an example, let us take 25 multiplied with 65. Firstly, we will take 5 which is on the units place and multiply them and write its answer separately, which gives us 25. Now we will multiply the number on the tens place, which is 2 and 6, which gives us the answer as 12. Now we will take the average of the numbers on the tens place, which are 2 and 6. So the average of 2 and 6 is 4. Now we will add 12 and 4, which gives us 16. So we'll write it over here. Now we got a final answer. 1625. 25 multiplied with 65 is 1625. Isn't it easy? For better understanding, let us take another example of 35 multiplied with 55. Firstly, we will take this 5 and multiply them and write it separately over here. Now we will take 3 and 5 which is on the tens place and multiply them, which gives us 15. Now we will take the average of 3 and 5 which are on the tens place, and the average of 3 and 5 is 4. Now we will add this 15 and 4, which gives us 19. So we got our answer. We'll write 19 over here and our answer is 1925. 35 multiplied with 55 is 1925. So now let us move on to trick number 2. Basically, trick number 2 is about calculating percentage more easier and more faster. Basically, there's a golden rule behind it, which is x% of y is always about y% of x. Understood? Let's simplify with an example. We'll take the example of 8% of 25. Isn't it little difficult to understand? We'll reverse it now, which is 25% of 8. Now, we all know that 25 is the 1/4 part of 100. So, we'll divide 8 by 4, which gives us 12. And our final answer is also 2. So, 25% of 8 is 2. And 8% of 25 is also 2. For better understanding, let us take another example of 13% of 50. It is also a little difficult to understand. So we'll reverse it. We'll write it as 50% of 30. Now, we all know that 50 is half of the 100. So we'll make 13 its half. And the answer is 6.5. And the final answer is also 6.5. 50% of 30 is 6.5, or 13% of 50 is 6.5. See, these tricks are very easy to understand. So, for more tricks, you can contact me. Thank you.
Hey guys, I am Jay Chatur from class 7th A, here with my topic, that is quantum computers. Quantum computing is more to the future of computing. This is a complete different kind of computer which is still in its very early day, but it does promise to revolutionize computer in a way that's still hard to fathom. We are talking about quantum computers. Basically, they calculate stuff a lot faster than a normal computers, like 100 million times faster, and they do it by quantum mechanics. In normal computer, bits are the smallest unit of information. Quantum computers use qubit, which can also be set to one of two values. Strangely, unlike regular bits, can represent a 0 and a 1 at the same time. Super complicated calculation will be done in a fraction of second. There will be able to give us data encryption with near perfect security, giving accurate weather prediction, help the scientists discover miracle materials and miracle curious for disease, and even revolutionize our understanding of many branches of science. To say this one could be a game changer is putting it lightly. Remember, though quantum computers are still in their infancy, but there are signs of moving forward. Google already has quantum computers and last year made a quantum leap forward when it took just 200 seconds to solve a problem that was considered a virtual impossible. The world's most powerful computer that once that errant quantum would have taken 10,000 years to finish it, and that one did it in 200 seconds. Amazing, right?
Theologian and author. He gave us the theory of three laws of motion.
Now my friend Kavish Vade will explain you the first law.
The first law. An object will not change its motion through unless it's a force acts on it. The motion of ball falling down through the atmosphere is the example of first law.
Now my friend Ayanth Rani will explain you the second law.
The second law is the force of an object is equal to the mass, time and its acceleration. Riding a bicycle is an example of second law.
Now my friend Manav Jain will explain you the third law.
The third law is when two objects interact, they apply force to each other of equal magnitude and opposite direction. Example, jumping and Newton's cradle are the example of the third law.
Newton's cradle was invented by English actor Simon Preble and named it so in honor of Newton's, Isaac Newton's, and employs its Newton's law.
Newton's cradle purpose is to demonstrate the principle of conservation of momentum, that is mass times speed. It is also a great example of third law of Newton's law of motion.
It also demonstrates the law of conservation of energy. Energy can neither be created nor destroyed. It can only convert from one form to another form of energy.
The steel balls lose energy to many things. They lose energy to air as they move through it. They make some energy when they collide, and they lose energy to heat upon collision. We will tell you the materials that we use to make a project.
Wood, sharp cutters,
steel balls and
scissors
and saw.
Respected teachers and dear friends, my name is Nadish Anjaria and my topic is excretory system. So on this tour, I'm your guide to the excretory system, which you can see it right here. It consists of six parts, namely the two kidneys, the renal artery, the renal vein, the ureter, urinary bladder and the urethra. The kidneys are two bean shaped structures in which there are small tiny particles named nephrons which filter the blood and then pass it to the ureters. Now the ureters are a narrow tube like structures which transport the impure substances to the collecting bag, also known as urinary bladder. Now below the urinary bladder, as you can see, here is the urethra, which is also a small tube like structure. It's very small, and from there, now I'm going to show you a practical of this video.
So I'm just going to pour water. And the water is going through the ureters and coming out here, right here. Yes. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Nihan Siddiqui, and today we are going to do an experiment of making an instant ice without using a refrigerator. So the requirements of today's experiment are 100 grams of baking soda, 115 milliliters of vinegar, and 25 milliliters of water. So today we are going to add 100 grams of baking soda in the container. Baking soda, we will add 115 milliliters of vinegar. After adding vinegar, we will wait for 1 hour for the mixture to settle down.
Now we are going to add 25 milliliters of water in the mixture. So the mixture will, and we will wait for the mixture to boil and wait for the clearance of the mixture.
After boiling, we will pour the solution in the glass and wait for the solution to cool down at the room temperature. So here the ice has started forming from the below and it will be formed.
Good morning, teachers and my dear friends. Once again came the best science exhibition called the Nirman exhibition. This year, while this pandemic, we were not allowed to go out of our home, and also we was not able to get more equipments. Hence, we didn't made anything great. But I have still tried a lot and make a choco box. There were 3 friends of mine who supported me while this project. There were Aryan, Vedant and Palak. They supported me a lot, give me inspiration to make this project. They helped me a lot as the measurements, the ideas, all were given by them. And hence, I will show you how this project looks and what I think, what are the things I did while making this project.
So this is the project model that I have made with the support of my friends, and this has 2 sections, Copico and Londonderry. I have named it as my choco box, and made by in 2 days. Actually, I can pull it and show you a practical. So I have done a practical over here, and this was of the Copico section, and there's the Londonderry section. I have also opened it and showed, and now my friends also helped me while this project, and I will show you how they what did they discovered.
Good morning, teachers and my dear friends. I am Palak and our project is Choco Box. We all attended Zoom meeting and helped Prithvi in making this project. I discovered that this box doesn't keep chocolate safe, but also it keeps many small small things. Now my friend Aryan will explain to you what he discovered while he projected.
To teachers and all my dear friends. My name is Aryan and we all have together made a small and useful project. This is a choco box. It helps us to keep our chocolates protected and it is a big saving instead of buying an expensive box to keep our chocolates in. Now my friend Vedant will tell what he discovered in this project.
Good morning to all my dear friends and my respected teachers. My name is Vedanja and our project was Choco Box. I love the involvement in making the project. We all coordinated together and our group member Prithvi has made it. We all have supported him. So thank you Prithvi and thank you to all.
Hello everyone. My name is Roshan Dalvekar from 7th A and my Nirman topic for this year is gears and how it works. So what are gears? A gear is a type of simple machine. We can move things using gears. A gear is a wheel with teeth that fixes with one another. When one gear moves, the rotatory motion transfer from the first gear to the second gear and hence the second gear begins to move. Gears are often a combination of wheels with varying diameters. In such a case, they can be used to increase the power of a turning force. The smaller wheel moves with more speed but lesser force, while the bigger one moves with a lesser speed with more force. Now I will demonstrate how gears work. As you can see that these are two gears and their teeth are slotted together. Now when the gear moves, you will observe that the smaller gear moves with higher speed but lower force, and the bigger one moves with a low speed while applying a higher force. This was an example of gears being connected together by direct contact. Gears can also be connected together by a chain or a belt. For example, in a bicycle, when you cycle, the force is carried through the pedals to the tire to move the bike. The chain can also be switched between gears of different sizes to increase the speed, for example while racing, or to increase the pressure, for example while climbing a steep hill. To conclude, if gears are used effectively like in cars and bicycles, they can achieve amazing speeds which our bodies could never match without help. Gears have made our life very convenient. I hope you enjoyed this presentation and found it to be very informative. Thank you for watching this video. Goodbye.
Hello everyone, I am Samantha Ganji from class 7th A, making a project on how electricity is generated from potato. In most commercial batteries, electricity is generated by a chemical reaction between two anodes, copper and zinc, and electrolyte sulfuric acid. The fluid in potato acts as the electrolyte and generates electricity between two electrodes. Zinc wire are commonly used metal for anodes in batteries. The nail reacts with the electrolyte in the flesh of the potato. The electrons travel through the nail to light up the bulb and then flow back through the thick copper wire. A potato battery will last up to 2 to 5 days, so we can make use of potato when we don't have electricity. This is my project. We have used simple 2 zinc bolts which are connected with a wire to the light. Now I'll turn on the light and show you that it really works. As you can see that the light light bulb has turned up. Thank you for seeing my project.
Hello everyone, my name is Swarup and today welcome to our Nirman online exhibition. Me and my friend Prem will explain you about some of the properties of the triangle. So let's start. Firstly, I'm gonna explain you about the incident angle. The angle drawn on any point on the circumference to any other two points on the circumference is called the incident angle. Now my friend Prem will explain you about the second property of the triangle.
If we form a triangle on a semicircle, then its angle will most definitely be 90 degrees. The reason is because if we turn this triangle by 180 degrees, then it will form a rectangle. As you know, a rectangle forms an angle of 90 degrees. So that is why the triangle will also have an angle of 90 degrees.
Now I'm going to explain you about the central angle. The angle drawn from the circle, center of the circle to any other two points on the circumference is called the central angle. The central angle is always double the incident angle. And if we move the point to any other point on the circumference, both the angles will be equal. Now my friend Prem will explain you about the fourth property of the triangle.
This is a quadrilateral, a four-sided polygon. The sum of the opposite angles of this quadrilateral will always be 180 degrees, no matter wherever the points are. This was our project on the topic Properties of Triangles for our Nirman exhibition. Thank you. Stay home and stay safe.
Good morning ma'am, my name is Yash Uffal and today I will show you the working of volcano. Before showing the working of volcano, I will brief you that why volcano erupts. Volcano erupts because of the melting rocks such as magma rises up till the earth's surface. Magma is formed because of the earth's surface steadily melts. Melting can happen in the tectonic plates also by pulling apart or pushed down. Magma is lighter than rocks also, so can reach till the earth's surface. During the magma rises, gas bubbles are formed inside it. Magma is a thick gas bubble, so cannot easily escape. Now I am showing the working of volcano. First, I will add some baking soda in it. Now I will add some cold drink. Now you can see that volcano is coming out from there.